What's up, guys? Welcome back to Tul World. This is Mr. Ju, and I'm here with Master Ju.
Hello, Mr. Ju.
Hello. Thanks for jumping back in. So, one of the students asked, how many counter attacks should you do in a step sparring set? We have pre-designed sets, but you can always go on and make your own as well. So, is there an appropriate amount of counter attacks?
Yeah, I don't think there's a rule, really, right? So we have created some sets mostly to help the students come up with different ideas. I mean, if you leave it to the student's hand, it's usually just a block and a punch or something. So you're not utilizing all of the skill sets. Mm-hmm. And why do we use step sparring? General Che always said that the most important one was three-step sparring and one-step sparring. Mm-hmm. Why three-step sparring? Well, three-step sparring is really more about learning distance, how far they are, maybe working with some angles, right? And that's part of the training secrets of Taekwondo, is angles. One-step sparring is more like, in a way, more like self-defense. You're standing around, all of a sudden here comes an attack, and I have to defend against that. So, you should try to utilize different techniques so that you experience those techniques and how you would respond to it.
Okay.
So when we talk about three-step sparring and how many counterattacks should we have, I think that counterattacks are, well, really what we're trying to do is to have one blow, one kill, or one stop.
Mm-hmm.
Shouldn't say kill too much, huh?
Is that the PG version?
The PG version. Is that we should just one blow, that's it. That's awesome. That'd be great if we could do that.
Right.
But you've done a lot of sparring. How many times have you hit somebody and did it stop somebody? Not very often.
Yeah.
Not very often.
Yeah.
I mean, it does. You do a side piercing kick on someone and you hit them in the abs and it might take the wind out of them. That stopped them.
Mm-hmm.
That's awesome. That'd be great. But a lot of times that doesn't happen. And why is that? Especially when you're dealing with someone that has more experience, you've got someone that's moving around a lot. And so what you might end up having to do, if you're, let's take a think about sparring, for instance, if you're out there sparring, are you not thinking, it's more like a chess game, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Where you think, okay, if I do this, he's going to do this. If I do that, he's going to do this, and so forth. And so multiple attacks can be used more like to set up for that one blow final kill.
Right.
Or one, that's why you'd have multiple attacks or counterattacks.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's the same with step sparring.
Mm-hmm.
So you should do techniques. So I should think a little bit more about it. If I was doing counterattack, three-step sparring, I want to set it up so that I can do an outward knife hand, downward knife hand strike or something. Well, how are you going to get there?
Mm-hmm.
You first got to set it up. Maybe it's a low kick to the leg, or maybe it's a counterattack to the groin area so that he kneels over.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can do a downward knife hand strike.
Yeah.
So that would be my thoughts on multiple attacks.
Yeah. Definitely.
What's your thoughts?
No, I totally agree. The way I was explaining it to the student was that, you know, if you're having to do like 20 punches for a counterattack, then firstly you need to go back and work on your four fist punches, because you want to get it down as little as possible, because when you're in like a sparring situation or self-defense, you don't want to be wasting your energy on techniques that aren't working.
Right. I mean, if you had to do 20 counterattacks,
you
gotta
go back
to drawing.
Yeah.
that's true. But so that's interesting. So if you think about like different patterns, I mean, we can bring this back to different patterns. There are specifically like dosan, right? You do the wedging block and you do the kick and then you do punch. Those are all multiple attacks. That's really like a multiple counterattack, isn't it?
Yeah.
Kick and two punches. So why fast and why regular?
From what I've thought about it, the fast would be like two quick consecutive punches. The regular is like when you hit somebody and you have to load it up again, as in you didn't do enough damage there. So you gotta bring it back, execute your sine wave, and fully extend again.
I agree. So we do it fast, it's like bang bang, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
And he's down. But sometimes you might hit someone that's pretty big, and it's bang, and he's not going anywhere. Because if you hit somebody, right, one time, and probably if you hit him hard enough, or maybe just enough so that he would move away, then the second punch isn't going to work.
Yeah.
Right?
That's true.
And so it would be just a waste of time to go bang, and he moves away, and then throw another technique.
Right.
However, you might find a person that you hit them, they're a big guy, they're not moving, boom, okay, I need to throw another punch, and I've got to use maximum power. So I'll go down, up, down again, and I use regular type of technique on that individual again, right?
Right.
So yeah, I think that's understanding when do we use certain techniques, when is it fast, when's it regular, why is it that?
Going back to the step sparring and the one blow, one kill, that's not the only time that we see the number one in Taekwondo.
Well, I think that whole concept or that idea, you see it throughout the patterns, the names of the patterns, right? For instance, what does the one mean, right? One blow, one kill, or loyal to one king or one person. You know, we asked, can you do multiple martial arts? Well, can you ride two horses at the same time? To get some smart remark like, yes, you can. You put right foot on one horse and you put the left foot on the other horse and you could ride two, like in the circus, you know?
Yeah.
Right. But whoever does that?
No, not
that very often, right? Yeah. I mean, yes, it's possible. I think what you're referring to is the belt. Why do we do a single wrap belt versus a double wrap? I think a lot of martial art, karate specifically, maybe the Japanese arts are double wrap.
Yeah.
And so what's your take?
Well, I know that Taekwondo originally started as a double wrap, but we also started wearing karate gis originally. And in around the 1980s that we had transitioned to doing a single wrap belt. But still some styles of Taekwondo still use the double wrap as well.
Maybe WTF?
The WTF, yeah.
Right. No, absolutely. I remember, because I started in the early 80s, and I do remember my first uniform was a crossover, and I double wrapped my belt. And there's a certain way of doing a double wrap to make it look like a single wrap. I don't know if people know that.
Yeah.
But if you, like a lot of people, they start from the front and then they go around twice, and on the back it's crossed, right? And so you can make it so it looks like a single wrap, but that's the way I used to wear the belt, was a double wrap. And then about around 1984 maybe, they introduced a new uniform and the single wrap belt. But the uniform was a baby blue and it had a zipper.
Oh, nice.
You can hardly get that one. I wish I had one of those, though.
Yeah.
It would be a collector's. Mm-hmm. Whoever's got one out there, that's a collector's. Mm-hmm. That was kind of like the first time we saw this uniform that was pulled together at the center, like a jacket.
Yeah.
Right? Because everything else was a crossover. And then shortly after that, someone came up with this idea about this Velcro or zipper. Actually, I think it was mostly zipper. Mm-hmm. And it was in the center, but it was white. And a single wrap happened about that time, but very few people had it. But the idea was the single wrap represent one art. Mm-hmm. It represented the one kill, the one blow, the one master, right? Mm-hmm.
Right.
And you can't serve two masters. I mean, you could, but there's always a conflict of interest in there down the road.
I think if you look at General Che's kind of whole philosophy was always about, you know, dedicating your life to one thing, really.
Yeah, to be a master.
To be a master, right.
I mean, you've heard that term, right? Mm-hmm. Jack of all trades, but master of none. Mm-hmm.
Don't forget to leave us a comment below about the one. Thanks for jumping in this week. Don't forget to be safe.
Keep training.
And have a great week.
Take one.